To the session on soil characteristics. In the previous class, we have already talked about what is soil and the various layers or the horizons of the soil. Now, when we talk about characteristics, let's first understand the first term that we have used in the previous class, that was PED. PED is a unit of soil structure that we talk about. Now, this unit of soil structure can be arranged by various means. There can be parallel arrangement, there can be clumping, there can be binding of soil, and so on. So now what we need to understand is what are the basic characteristics that we can find in the soil and what are the various characteristics that affect the growth of plants in the soil. So soil, when we talk about, has three basic classification of we can classify the characteristics by three basic types. One is the physical characteristics, the chemical characteristics, and the biological characteristics. Today, under physical characteristics, we would be talking about the structure of the soil, the texture and the size of the soil, moisture content, color, the difference between permeability and porosity, depth, acidity, and the drainage. Under chemical characteristics, we would be talking about the organic and the inorganic content. And under the biological characteristics, we would be talking about the effect of microorganisms in the soil. Now, let's first start with the first physical characteristics, that's the structure of the soil. The structure of the soil can be of various types. It can be prismatic, columnar, blocky, platy, or granular. Now, the most common is the granular soil, which is found in most of the grasslands. Most suitable or ideal for soil cultivation or agricultural purposes. So that's the granular soil. Then you have the blocky. Blocky soil can be either angular or subangular. These blocky soils or blocky pieces are formed due to breaking up of the rocks. So you have breaking of rocks that leads to formation of the blocky soil, and that blocky soil is usually again due to expansion and shrinking of the clay. So you have a clay particle. When it expands, it grows and then it shrinks again. So what is formed here is the crack, and these cracks are the region where water penetrates in. So this is a specific characteristic of the blocky soil. Blocky soil can be either angular, which has sharp angles here, or it can be subangular. The next is platy. Platy pieces, the most important characteristics to identify those are, they are arranged in kind of plates. The thicker, the middle section is the thickest, and it is thin towards the edges. So you have thickest section in the center and you have thin edges towards the thin edges, so it's towards the corners. It's usually found in C, E, B, and K horizons. It has lots and lots of schizoxoids. The common elements found are iron and magnesium. The next two that we would be talking about today is prismatic and columnar. So columnar are vertical columns, and these vertical columns are such tightly packed that it is very difficult for roots to penetrate deep. So penetration of the roots into depth of the soil becomes very difficult in the columnar soil. And last is prismatic soil. Here you have the freeze and thaw action or dry and wet cycles that promote the prismatic section of the soil, usually commonly found in B horizon. This is one of the most popular characteristics. So prismatic and granular are the most commonly found soil types or the soils based on structure. The next under our classification was the structure and the size. Now, structure and size, some of it we have already covered in the previous lecture. We have talked about the soil triangle, we have talked about the sand, silt and clay. We'll be talking about the bigger particles of the soil that are known as boulder, cobble, then you have pebble. So boulder is greater than 256 millimeter in size. Greater than that would be boulder. Then you have cobble between 64 to 256 millimeter. Then you have pebble between 4 to 64 millimeters, and so on. And then the classification of sand, silt and clay we have already talked about. So let's go back. So texture and size we have already talked about. This is the classification of the bigger particles. Then we will talk about the next thing is the moisture content in the soil. Now moisture content in the soil is affected by how porous the soil is. So where the particles are bigger, there would be large pores, and what would happen is water would penetrate deeper. So there would be low soil moisture. So low soil moisture would be present in the regions of bigger particles. In the region where there are small particles, what would happen is these particles would be closely packed. So water penetration would become difficult. So there would be more water retention. So what would happen here is water retention. So that is another characteristic of the soil that is based on moisture. Now let's understand the most important phenomena, that's color. Color, when we define, is characterized by three basic elements. One is hue, value and chroma. So for color, we talk about three basic elements. One is hue, one is value, and other is chroma. Hue is the pure color. Value is the lightness or the darkness of the soil particle, and chroma is the color purity. Now how do we define these elements? Let's move on to a simple diagram here. So here you have a diagram to help you understand the Munsell color system. We would be talking about this in very brief today. So you have the hue, that's the pure color, that's denoted by this ring. So under this ring we can say this hue falls in the range between purple and blue. So the hue here is purple blue. Chroma is the extension that you can see, that is touching here, that's 6. So chroma here is 6, the purity of the color is 6. And you have the value that's on the perpendicular scale, that's 5. So the value in this case is 5. This is how we read the Munsell color system. So the vertical line denotes the value. You have the circular dimension that denotes the hue, and the extent to which it comes out denotes the chroma or the purity. Now value is determined from 0 to 10. 0 is the highest darkness, 10 is the lightest form. So that's the color system, and based on this we determine the soil. Now there are various characteristics of soil and various types of soil. You have a kind of Chernozem soil which is black. The other soil that you have is red and yellow soil that is formed due to oxidation of iron. So oxidation of iron creates a red and yellow soil. You have Chernozem soil which is black, and the color of these soils can be determined by the Munsell color system. So that was the next thing that we have done today. The next is porosity versus permeability. Now these two terms most of the students often get confused. The thing that is porous needs to be permeable, but that's not the case. Let's understand the difference between porosity and permeability. Porosity basically means how much deep or the capacity to hold water. So that is porosity. It's the capacity to hold water. The next is permeability. Permeability talks about transportation of the fluid. So I have a very fine surface of net. Then when I talk about porosity, I would be talking about the holes in the net. When I would be talking about permeability, I would be talking about how much water can percolate down from that net, and that would be the permeability. So you have a small difference that lies between porosity and permeability. Now when I talk about porosity, I say it increases with texture. So if there are bigger size particles, the porosity would increase. So you have huge boulders here which are highly porous, a lot of water can be held within this particles, but permeability decreases with texture. So for a soil to be highly permeable, you need to have minute particles, and you need to see the permeability in these particles, which is much higher as compared to this. So porosity is the capacity to hold water, while permeability is the transportation of the fluid. So that was the next element that we have talked about. Now let's move on to the rest of the physical characteristics. The next is depth. Now the soil that is deep would have good capacity for tap-rooted plants. Now when we talk about root system of a plant, it can be either, usually the roots are either spread onto the ground or some of the roots go straight and deeper. So for the roots which go straight and deeper, the depth of the soil is very essential characteristics. So if the soil is deep, it would hold the plant more tightly. As a result, it would prevent erosion, it would prevent unrational transportation of the soil particles. The next is acidity. We measure acidity on the scale of pH. A pH of 7 is considered as balanced. pH less than 7 is considered acidic, and more than 7 is considered basic. If I say the soil has a pH of around 8.3, that means the soil has excessive sodium in it. In contrast to it, if I say the soil has a pH of less than 7, that means soil is acidic in nature. When the soil is acidic in nature, I say it's low in sodium, potassium, calcium. So these contents are low in a acidic soil. In contrast to that, you would have higher content of, say, aluminium, iron, manganese would be higher in a acidic soil. When the pH is high, you would have more of sodium based elements that would be found in the soil. The next is drainage. Based on the drainage, I can classify the soil as either excessively drained. For example, if I talk about rice plantation, rice is grown in the area which is excessively drained. So you have water that is being flooded into the fields, and under that soil only you can grow paddy crops. So you can have excessively drained soil, you can have well drained soil, you can also have poorly drained soil. What does poorly drained soil means? The drainage of the soil is not good, usually found in the areas of desert. So this was the physical characteristics of the soil. The next we would be covering today is the chemical and the biological characteristics. Now let's first start with biological characteristics. Under biological characteristics, the only thing that we would be talking about today is the role of microorganisms. Now microorganisms or any living characteristics in form of animal life is known as fauna. In contrast to it, plant life is known as flora. So if I use word fauna, I am talking or dealing with animals or microorganisms. If I use flora, I am dealing with plants. That's the first thing you can understand. The next is introduction of the term micro, meso, and mega or micro. So these are the terms I commonly use. So you have microfauna, mesofauna, and macrofauna. As the name suggests, micro means small. You have meso means medium, and you have macro means large. Now, what is a microfauna? Microfauna is in the form of bacteria, fungus growth that is found in the soil. So, very small particles, not visible by naked eyes, usually of the size of less than 0.1 millimeter, are considered under microfauna. Then next is mesofauna. Mesofauna includes small elements like mites from the size of 0.1 to 2 millimeters, and larger than 2 millimeters would be macrofauna or megafauna. Macrofauna usually includes small elements, small insects like earthworms. You have centipedes, slugs, and so on. So these would be included under macrofauna. Microfauna technically includes bacterial growth, and mesofauna includes growth of mites. You have very small insects that can be seen. So these come under mesofauna. So these are demarcated on the base of size. So less than 0.1 millimeters, 0.1 to 2 millimeters, and more than 2 millimeters. So with this we cover the microorganism section of the soil. The next is the organic content and the inorganic content. Let's first talk about the inorganic content or the mineral content of the soil. When I talk about the mineral content of the soil, we explain the soil content based on three elements. First is the essential element. Essential elements are those elements which are required by the soil. These essential elements can be either macro or micronutrients. Macro again means large or which are required in huge quantity. Micronutrients are those which are required in minor quantity. So first is the essential, and the second is the non-essential. So you have the non-essential element. Now, as I have talked about, the essential elements includes either micronutrients which are required in huge quantity and micronutrients which are required in less quantity. So micronutrients would include iron, vanadium, aluminium, traces of zinc, boron. So these would all go under micronutrients. On the other hand, you have micronutrients which are required in huge quantity, like sodium, potassium, phosphorus. That is the basic NPK fertilizer that we use, N, P and K. So you have nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium. Based on the names derived from the periodic table, you have the NPK fertilizer. Those are the macronutrients. Besides this, there are other micronutrients like calcium, magnesium. So these come under the macronutrients, and all these elements, whether they are required in large quantity or small quantity, are essential nutrients for the soil or the plant to grow. Besides this, there are some non-essential nutrients like sodium, silicon. So these are some of the non-essential elements that are not required by the plant to grow. The next is the organic content. Now, what do we mean by organic content? Organic content is any content which is formed by decomposition of either plants or animals. So, decomposition of plants or animals in any form would create what is known as humus, which is formed by breakdown of the organic matter that is present. This humus in particular is a dark colored material that is formed on the top of the soil. Now we can classify humus into three broad criterias again. You have more, mull, and modder. Now what is the best way to help us remember the concept of more, mull, and modder? So O comes before U, so O would be first, U would be second, and this is MOD, modder, that means moderate. That means this modder lies in between more and mull. That's the first thing we need to understand. Now mull has low moisture, more has low moisture and low biological activity in contrast to this mull has higher moisture and higher biological activity and where will I fit modder then so modder lies as I said it's moderate derived from the word moderate so modder lies between more and mull So it does not have very high moisture, it does not have very high biological activity. It lies between more and mull. Now for more, the best areas that we classify for more are the coniferous regions. More humus is usually found in coniferous areas. In contrast to this, you have mull which is found in grasslands and vegetation. Vegetation areas. So with this we cover the organic content. Now we have talked about the various characteristics of the soil in this session. In the next session we would be talking about soil erosion, its causes and the methods to conserve the soil erosion. You can subscribe to ExamRace channel for any further updates. Till then, have a